I'm right there with you.
I've been behind them.
I noticed you said behind.
Yes.
Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. I've got a couple of things that we need to address. Let's go to the Lord first. Good morning, Father. Thank you for your presence here. Thank you for your love, your purity, your provision for us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the comfort that you have given us and that you are giving John. This life is not the real life. This is just a test. We are going to come into the true life, the eternal life, with you. I know what you call for us, where you come down and bring us up. Thank you for the comfort that you have given us so we can share that comfort with John. Be with us this morning, Lord, as we go into your word, that we will do so with an open heart and an open mind, and that we will seek to have a deeper, closer relationship with you. That is one of the purposes you left us behind, and that we would then use that deeper relationship to witness to others, which is the main reason we're still here. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me know. Come on in. Knows that Bernice, John Michael's wife, went for her appointment with the Lord this past week. It was very, very peaceful. This is, of course, a very difficult time. I mean, I have not lost a wife, but I've lost a brother and sister.
The beautiful two brothers, relationship that she allowed me to have is while she was still responsive, I just leaned over and kissed her on the forehead and said, "Sweetheart, it's going to be a short time. We're going to be together again." And I asked her, I said, "Do you know that?" And I saw her unmistakable nod of the head. And she knew that. So that was comforting. My tears are alternating tears of joy for her. As Adrian Rogers would say, she's kicking up gold dust in heaven.
I like that.
Well, he had a lot of things that I like. Yeah. All of them scripture based.
Yeah.
So,
kind of
anyway, thank you.
Richard.
Yeah. Thank you. And I decided to confront the sadness and the missing head on. So yesterday I took her car. I just bought a new car for her after being rear-ended and demolished her precious before. But it was the Lord's way of putting a most remarkable vehicle in her family. She got to use it two times. We went to the harbor once, and it was the car that brought her from the hospital.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
She had nothing to do yet. She enjoyed it those two times. Anyway, I decided I'm going head on into this grief business, because she wouldn't want grief on because of her. And the Lord doesn't want us to extend grief. We do grieve, and that's a normal process that we have. So I drove over to the harbor yesterday, and in the process of doing that, the Lord gave me a person that I witnessed to, and had a good conversation with right there on the little bench right there where we all are.
Oh, that's wonderful.
I can tell you a story. I talk
body. She did her toes and she did her fingernails. So she left with a fresh paycheck.
That is my deal.
And her humor was present up until the end. The nurse would want to say, we need to take blood. And she said, okay, that'd be 25 cents. And they didn't want to do it. Well, that'd be another dime for that.
Started this trend of has something to do with the rabbis have to, the priests, I should say, have to figure out something about when, it has something to do with the position of the moon. And I think,
is that the Day of Atonement?
No, the Day of Atonement is one week after Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah is the new year.
Oh.
Yeah. And, you know, when you read him, he follows, it makes sense. I have one objection to that. His theory is that the first three festivals, the festival of unleavened bread, Passover, and the first fruits, and the Pentecost, all occur in the spring. And he, and then the next festival, there's a long silent summer where, you know, at the end of the summer, there's a harvest. And then, and then you come to Rosh Hashanah. So his theory is that the next fulfillment of the festivals will occur in the fall. And there's a lot of people who look at that and they say, okay, I can see that Jesus came and he fulfilled the Passover feast, which is one of the feasts that, you know, they had to attend. And then the feast of first fruit was his resurrection. He was the first fruit. And then I can see that he, the Pentecost occurred. And so all of the feasts, the religious feasts, had a fulfillment in Jesus Christ. And I totally believe that. I agree with him 100% of that. You know, but I want to point out something to you. Those were religious feasts for the Jews. I am careful not to apply promises made or situations that relate to the Jews to relate them to the church. You know, and he is thinking the church will be raptured on Rosh Hashanah. I don't think so. I think, I go back to what Jesus said. Jesus gave us the name of the person who knew the precise time of the rapture. And I told you his name before. It's no one. It's a guy called no one.
That was a father.
Yes, except for the father, correct. And so, I'm always reluctant when I hear people saying, I figured out the date of the rapture. The second part of it, it is that I believe that his second coming, remember there's a difference between his coming on the clouds and his coming in the clouds. When the Bible speaks of the rapture, it speaks of Jesus coming in the clouds, and he will call us up. His feet does not touch the ground during the rapture. He calls us up
to meet him in the air.
To meet him in the air.
Yeah.
Okay. On his second coming, which occurs 7 years later, you know, there's a tribulation in the three. At his second coming, he comes on a horse on the clouds. He's riding on the clouds. And I believe that the second coming will occur on Rosh Hashanah when the trumpet is blown. Because in Rosh Hashanah, in Rosh Hashanah, the blowing of the trumpet has to occur at a precise time.
The ram's horn.
Yeah, the shofar. It occurs at a precise time that the rabbis have to figure out. And I have to go back and read it in some detail, but it's not. It's not predictable exactly. We know roughly the day, but knowing the precise time for blowing the shofar has to be. It's a complicated. It's more complicated than just midnight. And so, my attitude has been, no, I think. Where he has gone wrong is that he's applying something that is meant for the Jews to
more generally.
The generally to the church. I believe he will return on Rosh Hashanah at the end of the tribulation. no difference with Jonathan Trump. But I don't think it's serious enough that we will be doing pistols, you know, walking tall places. I don't think so. Yes.
What do you think of all of his parallels to, like, the Clintons and Trump?
Yes.
Is J.U. Uh-huh. And with 9/11 is
yes.
where he kind of started
yes.
doing this thing
mm-hmm.
where
yes.
he
yes.
could say he could show the olive tree and the what's the other
the
sycamore tree
no.
that was at the 9/11 location.
The vine, the olive tree, and the fig tree.
I think it was there was a tree that was actually at 9/11. I think it was a
sycamore. Oh yeah, it was a sycamore. Yes, yes, yes. I know what you're referring to. Yes.
And the whole bit about we will rebuild and the
right, and the stones that it so happened that the stones that they took from the quarry
almost to the minute.
Yes,
and
uh-huh.
then Trump
uh-huh.
is Jehu and the Clintons are the Jezebel and Ahab. And
yes.
Obama's the guy in between that followed just before Jehu, but
yes.
after Jezebel.
Yes. Uh-huh.
What do you think about and like America's sort of like a almost like a shadowy repeat of ancient Israel.
Correct. Uh-huh.
What do you think of all that stuff?
I think he's on the right track there to a significant, if not a total extent. I think that the parallels between Israel and United States, I think he begins on the right footing. Israel is a nation founded by God. Okay? Israel was not founded by man. And you might think it's supposed to know. Israel is a nation founded by God. The United States is a nation that was founded on biblical principles. The United States was not founded by God. It was founded on the Bible. There's no question when you read the founding documents of this country that the people who founded this country believed in God. You know, people like to say that Thomas Jefferson was an atheist. You know, he was a deist. A deist is a person who believes in God, but believes God, you know, wind up the world and went on the vacation. A theist is a person who believes that God is alive and God actively involved in this creation. I would not caution you against reading his works. I mean, I think he's a brilliant teacher, and I think he's a great writer. I mean, if he didn't become a rabbi, he'd be a best-selling author. I'm serious. Clancy or something.
Excuse me. I didn't
want to
watch it if I should be. You know what I'm saying? That's why I asked.
Yeah, no, I'd watch it if I knew. I mean, I have no doubts about him. He is one of the rabbis, the Messianic rabbis that I listen to his works and his sermons because I think they're good. He gives a very brilliant sermon comparing the feasts in the book of Leviticus to the life of Christ. And I could probably do that, a version of that, because I have a book on that which probably is read by Jonathan got it from. It was written a long time ago. I could probably do a short version of that between our classes. But it's a good question, and I'm glad you asked the question. I listened to him, and I listened to another gentleman called Rabbi Schneider, another Messianic Jew. You're familiar with him?
Yeah.
And
he's a little younger.
Yes, he was talking about he had applied for citizenship in Israel under the law of return, and you have asked a bunch of questions, and the very last question that I met is, do you believe that Yeshua is God?
Yeah.
If you answer Yeshua, Jesus. And if you say yes, you do not qualify for citizenship. It's interesting that is the question. That,
even if you're full blooded.
Yeah. Yeah, it doesn't matter if you're full blooded. They're saying if you accept Yeshua,
they're actually starting to outlaw
scratch your tongue.
Yeah, I like him.
And I found that to be true.
He's kind of like Jim Vernon McGee.
Hey, they are grounded in the word, and they are all grounded in the same line.
Yes, yeah, word.
Absolutely.
Well, I'll tell you about the little digression, but we're going to go ahead and start now. I was talking last week about we are here to obey the people that God put in power. Understand something. In Genesis chapter 9, verse 6, God created government. And he created government to protect the weak, to provide for order in society and so on. I have no real problems. I don't have a problem with government. I mean, I like civil servants too much, but I'm okay with it. I'm okay with that too. You have to understand something very, very important. God created government. Genesis 9, verse 6. Man created politics, nepotism, and all the other bad things that we see. I was listening to someone questioning Dinesh D'Souza, and I was kind of surprised that Dinesh didn't give him a stronger answer, but he's saying, well, capitalism caused slavery. And I have to say, when did slavery start? It started in 1776. We had no slavery before then. No. All of the ancient societies depended on slavery. Every single one of them. Yeah. So, slavery existed long before there was capitalism. Yes.
And I've kind of noted, because I have a history, my history comes back from Czechoslovakia.
Yes, uh-huh.
And the word slave comes from Slav.
Yes.
Slavic.
Yes.
So it didn't start just with African Americans coming to.
Absolutely, none of them. In fact, that's why they're called Slavic people. Yeah. They were enslaved by the Romans and others. Yes. And in many cases, they were enslaved by their own people, the elite of their own society. So I want you to understand where I'm coming from. Understand, I said, government is ordained by God for the protection of the weak. It's a punishment of the wicked. And what was the rule of the law that God gave back in 9:6, Genesis 9:6? He said, if you shed human blood, your blood will be shed. Capital punishment. It is the critical foundation of a government. When you go to North Korea, what keeps you in line? The fear that if you do something wrong, Kim Jong-un will have you executed. In other words, the ultimate power of government is capital punishment. And when a society destroys Genesis 9:6, you will notice that things begin to deteriorate in that society. We have gone from getting rid of capital punishment. And it actually started, the problem started before that. Think of Madeleine Marie O'Hare and getting rid of teaching children in a prayer school. And you start to go downhill. You move away from God. That's what happened in the early 60s with them taking prayer out of schools. Then you go to removing the death penalty. And now we have passed a law in California that protects a thief committing thievery, and if you interfere with a thief in the commission of thievery, you are the criminal. You see what happens? The Page 40. Yeah. Now, you also notice that I have a distinct lack of interest in politics. In fact, I'm downright cynical. You probably didn't notice that picture about my personality. And that's because of this. I want you to understand something. We expend a tremendous amount of energy trying to fix things politically in this world, and it will never work. Why? Because God tells us it's going to go downhill. So, if I could only elect Joe Biden, things will be wonderful in this world.